siege. Minister, it goes without saying that gangland violence, feuds, executions, armed attacks, terrorising communities, violent turf wars to control the drugs trade, and all the accompanying evils that go with this sort of gangland violence should be condemned utterly, and we should seek to eliminate it. But I have to say, particularly from the government and the main opposition party, Fianna Fáil, I've really heard little in the way of actual solutions. And hand-wringing, condemnation, posturing, all of this hot air doesn't solve the problem. And while I have great sympathy for an under-resourced, understaffed Gardaí and for communities, particularly in rural areas, who've lost local Garda stations and who are concerned about that and want to see those returned, I have a great sympathy for all of those people. But quite frankly, I don't believe that no matter how many Gardaí you throw at this problem, that you will solve it. It hasn't worked anywhere else, and it won't work here. The United States is one of the most heavily policed countries in the world. They have one of the biggest, proportionately, prison populations in the world. But it is one of the most violent societies in the world. It is racked with gangland violence, and despite all of the efforts going right back to the 20s and 30s to deal with mobsters, the mafia, violent crime, they have failed and failed abysmally. And generation after generation, gangland violence, mafia-style violence, mobster violence reproduces itself again and again and again. Take another country particularly associated with this, Russia, where you have a virtual police state, an incredibly repressive, brutal state that is willing to use the most ruthless means to police its population generally and to go after elements, criminal or otherwise, that it considers a problem. Does it stop criminality, mafia-style violence in Russia? Not at all. Along with the United States, it's one of the countries worst impacted, absolutely racked with this kind of gangland and mobster-style violence. So throwing police at it, building prisons, increasing prison populations simply doesn't work. And we have to deepen our analysis of why it is that this sort of crime reproduces itself again and again and again, particularly in developed societies. And to me, it is really quite obvious why that is the case. Just imagine you're a 10 or 11 or 12-year-old child at the moment, and you're living in emergency accommodation because you've just been turfed out by a landlord, maybe for the second or third time. And you have no idea when you will have a permanent or secure roof over your head. And you're put into, as is often the case, into hostels that are drug-infested, completely inappropriate and unsuitable for those young people. And imagine your difficulty in trying to engage properly with school. But in your school, in any event, they've cut the guidance counsellors. So there's no counselling available. And in the area where you live, they have slashed the youth outreach projects where people were previously employed to reach out to young people, to work with them, to try and link them in with important services, with mental health services, to try and resource and provide alternative activities that would steer them away from the apparently attractive life of crime or the money that can be made from involvement in the drugs trade. What does it feel for a 10 or 11 or 12-year-old in that sort of situation? Would you feel resentful? Would you feel angry? Would you feel you'd any stake in society, or would you feel very angry? And what if that was compounded by abuse, by mental health problems, by a history of drug addiction in the family, and where there's no services available? How likely is it that you would end up involved in crime? Frankly, it is amazing that more young people aren't involved in crime. That somehow most people in those desperate situations, despite everything, despite the lack of support and resources from the health services, in the area of mental health, in the area of special needs assistance, resource hours, counselling in school, despite all those things, most kids still manage to battle through. But is it any wonder that, some don't? And fall into, develop resentment towards society and fall into the world of crime and drugs. As I said, what's surprising is that more people, more young people don't. And you can identify them. And I raised during the leaders' debate, the television leaders' debate before the election, I've raised it several times in the Dáil about a small project in my area called the Oasis Project. But I'm going to keep talking about it, because it's in one of the most disadvantaged areas in the Dunleary Borough. And I can tell you, and the project workers who are working in that can tell you who the next gangland criminals are going to be. They can tell you at the age of 10 or 11 who are the ones who are going to get involved in violence and drugs and criminality. But it's not inevitable. Where this little small projects are in place, they can save these young people. They can steer them in alternative directions. I mean, I can only tell you anecdotally, although I was looking at the World Health Organization, and they confirmed this, that the people with mental health problems or with developmental problems are massively, disproportionately represented in prison populations in every single country in the world. And anecdotally, I can tell you, because they come into my clinic, I know them around my area, the number of people in prison and involved in criminality who were in industrial schools, in Magdalene laundries, who had undiagnosed dyspraxia or dyslexia or other developmental problems, who had major housing issues, had abuse issues in their family, are massively and disproportionately represented in our prison and criminal population. And in all of those areas, we have slashed the services and support at education, at health level, at every other level, which would help provide alternatives and steer young people away from criminality. To me, all the talk about dealing with crime is hypocrisy unless we get in at that ground level and give our young people alternatives.
Thank you, Deputy Boyd Barrett. Deputy